Do we need nuclear energy to stop climate change? More and more voices from science,
we actually might.
Environmental activists and the press have been saying so in recent years. But this comes as a shock to those who are fighting against nuclear energy and the problems that come with it. So, who's right? Well, it's complicated. To slow rapid climate change, the world needs to reduce greenhouse gas emissions to net.
I think there is a pretty simple answer to this. So we'll get to it as we move through the video, but it is, to give you a little spoiler alert, it's much safer than people realize. And we could be doing it now and it'd be emitting a lot less greenhouse gases and terrible things into the climate. So something to consider.
Zero. In 2018, three-quarters of global emissions were released through energy production, namely by burning fossil fuels. Energy is a broad term that describes all sorts of stuff, from moving things and people around, to putting things big and small together, or heating our homes. Currently, 84% of the world's primary energy comes from fossil fuels, 33% from oil, 27% from coal, and 24% from gas. Around 10% of the global oil supply is just used to burn in boilers to make our homes cozy and warm. Only about 16% of global energy is from low emission sources, almost 7% from hydroelectric, 5% from solar, wind, bioenergy, wave, tidal, and geothermal.
Doesn't mean that couldn't make up 100. Important to keep in mind. It's low because we're fighting against the status quo. And, you know, the way the world works in the biggest places, capitalism. So all these things are operated mostly by businesses. Businesses and the people who run them and own them aren't just going to want to give up all their money, you know? So unfortunately, that's, people don't put it in simple terms enough. Like, why are we destroying our, running this horrific experiment? And when we have technology that could stop climate, not stop it from continuing on from where we are, but stop making it worse, exacerbating the situation. Well, it's because we live in a capitalist world. And I'm not saying I'm against capitalism. Everyone knows there's problems, though.
Thermal combined, and about 4% from nuclear. So we pretty much rely on coal, oil, and gas to keep our civilization going, which means it's actually very hard to transition away from them. To have a chance of escaping fossil fuels without throwing humanity back into the Stone Age, one of the most impactful things we can do is to electrify as many sectors as possible.
Yep, and you know how we could do it? If we had better people, if we had better humans on the planet, right? If you had some better humans in these positions of power, in with money, you know, they could change things. They really could. We need more Elons. And so many people are against Elon, right? The guy is making a difference in this exact situation. Okay, that's big for our future. And people hate him for other reasons. And I get it. Like, you can hate him for other reasons, whatever. But, like, let's let him continue trying to make Tesla, you know, a big thing.
Things we can do is to electrify as many sectors as possible. Electricity is the stuff that appears like magic when you plug something into a socket so you can watch YouTube. Every industry that can switch from burning fossil fuels to electricity needs to do so, from electric cars to electric heaters. Why do we need to bet so hard on electricity? Because we can produce electricity with low emission technologies like solar, wind, or nuclear. So electricity is a real lever for a radical transition. But there are a few problems making this transition really hard. First of all, in most places in the world, electricity is still generated mostly by burning fossil fuels. And not only that, in the last 20 years, the world's electricity usage increased 73% in absolute terms. While we are installing renewables at record speeds, at the same time, the amount of fossil fuel we're burning for electricity still keeps rising year by year. Renewables have so far not been able to catch up with the demand for new electricity, and so despite our progress, emissions from electricity are still rising worldwide. The other alternative to fossil fuels is nuclear, and even though it's not renewable, its greenhouse gas emissions are tiny compared to burning stuff. But in the last 20 years, nuclear has basically stagnated. Countries like China, India, and South Korea built new reactors, while Germany and Japan have been actively taking their nuclear plants offline.
So when was this video published? 1 year ago. So, you know, about then, there was some changes in, say, Germany's stance on these things, basically because they were forced to. And then even more recently, more recently, with the war starting, they were forced to as well, with a lack of energy, you know, because of the whole Russia situation. But anyway, I'm sure they might mention it in this video, maybe. I don't know.
Which seems a bit weird if we look at the countries with the most low carbon electricity in the world that get most of their juice mainly from two sources, nuclear or hydropower. Take France and Sweden. In France, only around 10% comes from fossil fuels, while 67% comes from nuclear and 23% from renewables, primarily hydro. In Sweden, almost 30% comes from nuclear power and about 45% from hydro. So we know that nuclear energy can work at scale. On the technical side, because of the lack of investment and innovation in the last few decades, the majority of the world's nuclear reactors are pretty old technology that's very costly to replace. In most Western countries, building nuclear reactors has become very expensive for a variety of reasons, like a loss of know-how in constructing them, policy changes, and increased regulatory constraints, so it can take a decade or longer just to finish a power plant. In contrast, countries like South Korea, China, India, and Russia are able to build new nuclear reactors comparatively quickly and at a competitive cost. Still, generally in the West, the current generation of nuclear power plants are more expensive to build and maintain than most fossil fuel alternatives. There are also the concerns about nuclear waste and the fear of...
Yeah, so many problems. Natural gas is a huge step up from coal. It doesn't matter, though, because, you know, natural gas is still producing greenhouse emissions, and, you know, just getting natural gas requires burning through a lot of stuff that's going to produce more. And it's also really finite. Like, there's like 50 years left of what we currently know. Of course, there'll be more we can find. But, you know, if we just were to invest in some renewable tech, well, there, you know, it's a bit better, right?
Accidents, but we cover those.
So this is the major point, right? People scared of nuclear energy is basically the real reason why, you know, there's not more investment in nuclear energy. And when people say nuclear energy, what they really mean is nuclear fission, because, you know, nuclear energy also encompasses nuclear fusion, which is the thing we're still yet to figure out, which is what's happening in the core of the star, in our sky, the big one. And if we could get that to work, wow, that would be a new world.
In other videos in more detail. We have designs for nuclear reactors that solve many of their problems, namely small reactors that take less time and money to get started. There are also next generation technologies that can already turn radioactive waste into new fuel, but so far these have not been deployed at a scale where they can have a significant impact on the nuclear sector.
Wow, these look cool. Don't know much about these.
Considering these uncertainties, some argue that nuclear power is a dangerous relic of the past and that we should just let it go and focus on renewables. But while renewables undoubtedly are the future of electricity, they still have their own huge challenges to overcome before they can take over the vast majority of the electricity grid. The main problem is reliability and consistency. It's not always windy, and the sun doesn't always shine, especially in the morning.
It's not a real problem. Like, it might look like a problem, and it technically is a problem. But as you've seen with Elon, they've been innovating. You put money into an area, you innovate. And, you know, storing solar power, it's possible, you know. We just actually need to improve the tech, some innovations. And, you know, Tesla's already doing it with their Tesla Powerwall. So I don't, you know, this isn't a great answer because, you know, we actually can already store solar energy. So there's really no reason left to not invest completely, go hard in renewable tech. There really isn't. And so, you know, it's like, sure, we could just do the nuclear energy option, but like you're saying, it still does rely on finite resources. So whilst it might be best for our climate and global warming and things like this, that's true. You know, if we're going to just, if we need to change the entire grid in a massive way quickly, we may as well go to the option where you're not going to have to do it again in the future at some point. So why not do renewable storage? I mean, renewable energy. Like Elon always talks about, he believes we need to do this gradually. He thinks, you know, the transitioning from, you know, fossil fuels to renewables needs to be gradual. Otherwise, we could potentially, you know, plunge our civilization in the darkness. And he could be correct there. So, you know, that's probably, I think that's probably correct as well. So if you get annoyed by the rate at which we're changing, you know, it's understandable because we might just not make it in time. You know, if the, you might be asking why. That might sound really doom and gloom. Well, there's such a thing as runaway, you know, cascade effects, especially in, like, ecosystems, trophic cascades. You know, that's with ecosystems in terms of biology, right? We don't really understand the natural sort of, it is nature as well, but you know what I mean? The atmospheric ecosystems all that well in the physics and, you know, atmospheric physics, how it all works, even things as trivial as turbulence isn't, we can't really model it very well at all. So, yeah. But before we do, you know, I'm building something as well, and it's going to protect you from quantum computers, and it can, right? These are going to be, you know, a significant problem for society in the future, potentially in 3 to 5 years. And so you should start protecting yourself now, because capture now, decrypt later attacks are a real thing. So VPN encrypted data right now can be stolen and decrypted at a future date. And so I've built this with something called post-quantum cryptography. So it has these algorithms in it that actually theoretically can't be broken by one of these powerful quantum computers. Quantum computers already exist, by the way. This isn't like woo or, you know, something that doesn't exist. And post-quantum cryptography is a very real academic area. This just hasn't been created before. And so we created it. So if you want to come test out our beta, you should come have a play. It's pretty cool. Anyway, let's get back to this video.
Mornings and evenings when humans need the most electricity. The variations between seasons don't make this issue easier. To make renewables reliable and not risk blackouts, we need massive storage capacities where we can save energy collected when the sun or wind are at their peak and release it later when we actually need it. Until this is possible, other sources of electricity need to provide a controllable load that creates the reliability of supply that our civilization needs to run properly. Eventually, we will be able to do this with renewables, but we need a lot of batteries or storage power plants.
Yeah, we can already do it, though. That's an important point as well. And I agree, Barbara.
Right now, we simply don't have the tech and the capacities to make this transition fast enough to replace fossil fuels.
I think we could do it. I don't agree with that. I think it just takes money, and no one's willing to just waste a bunch of money. Like Elon. We need more people just willing to blow through 100 million to potentially change the world.
But even if we could, there's another aspect we have to take into account. We're not just trying to kick fossil fuels out of electricity, we're trying to replace energy with electricity. If we're going to electrify sectors that currently use fossil fuels, like cars or heating, we will need significantly more electricity than we're currently using everywhere around the world. And if the electricity needs of the world,
this is a good point,
population continue to grow as they have over the last 20 years, we'll need even more. It all comes down to one thing. No energy source is perfect. All have their own unique problems.
Unless you're talking about fusion. It's like, sure, fusion has its problems. But look, that star up in the sky, the big one, it's been burning for about 4.5 billion years. And it's got another 4.5, 5 billion years to go. So look, yeah, looks like a pretty good, pretty perfect source.
Renewables and nuclear energy require time, investment, and technological innovation.
Science.
Neither is ready to remove fossil fuels from our electricity grid.
It absolutely is. I honestly think Kurzgesagt is giving this point to just try and please everyone. I think they're trying to please everyone here. So we absolutely can do it right now. And we, you know, and unlike what Elon's saying about, you know, we need to do this slowly, I think he's also trying to do a bit of people pleasing. But I think he probably thinks that as well. I just think we really could change the grid pretty rapidly if we wanted to.
Although activists on both sides claim that they are. In the end, the question is how we want to deal with all these challenges. Should we give up nuclear immediately and at least temporarily accept higher emissions? Will we try to extend the life of current nuclear reactors and shut them down afterwards while solving the shortcomings of renewables? Or will we invest in new nuclear technology to get new nuclear reactor types that are cheaper and safer? Or...
You know, it would help if people like Jeff Bezos, you know, instead of sinking however many hundreds of millions into sort of super yachts, you know, he spent that on trying to get this tech ready for the rest of humanity. That would be good, right? You know, that's a big problem I have with Jeff and other people who spend significant amounts of money on things right now when the world is looking like it's, you know, faced with potential catastrophe, right? We need to actually spend those large sums of money on this, right? He's talking about, you know, we need more funding in these areas. It's like, Bezos, come on, man. What are you doing? Like, build us the future, please. Is nuclear fusion the way to go? No, I would say renewable energy tech like solar power is the way to go right now. We need to keep investing in fusion because fusion is potentially on the cusp of major breakthroughs in the next 10 years. But that's a gamble, right? That's a gamble. And so we need to split what we invest in and predominantly go with what's already proven, which renewable tech is. And as Elon's talked about often, they've done calculations at Tesla. You could power the world currently. I think it's with like, a 100 kilometer squared array of solar panels, I think he suggested, that could power the whole world right now. Claims a 10,000 square mile solar farm in the desert could power America. Okay, America. So I was a little bit off, not the world. But if that's 10,000 square miles for how many millions in America? It's like 350 million. It's probably like closer to 400 million now, yeah? So, you know, scale that up to 8 billion. And, you know, correct with this, scale up the 10,000 square mile, and it's still not that big, you know? And look, that's what 10,000 square miles looks like.
Will we maybe do both? Opinion part starts here. Considering the risks that climate change poses for the biosphere and humanity, any technology that has a chance of contributing to a solution should be pursued. That's just good risk management and strategy. If preventing rapid climate change as quickly as possible, not as opponents, but as partners. We know there's no time to waste, so we should keep all of our low-emission players on the field. As things are, both nuclear and renewables need innovation and investment.
Sick.
But if we don't know yet which technology will be ready how quickly, why not just invest in both and see what happens?
How good's the post-rock in the background? Good area of music.
Happens. And on the topic of capacities, if we take nuclear energy offline right now, then that missing capacity will be replaced, at least partially, by fossil fuels. Even nuclear power plants in the West are expensive in the long...
Well, you've got a phone, Carly. You'll be able to use it on your phone very soon. I'll give you guys an update on Cal after this video, because there's some cool news.
Run, it may be cheaper to build them as long as they prevent more fossil fuel capacity being added and paying for the consequences of rapid climate change. So, do we need nuclear energy? Well, it really depends how hard we choose to make things for ourselves. And in a world that's already having a really hard time quitting fossil fuels, why should we make things harder than necessary? Starting the change process.
That's a weak argument from Kurt Kazak. Why make things harder than necessary? Because we might die otherwise. Everyone might die. I think that's a pretty necessary argument. With 14 years old, I was able to, young and dumb, actually try to get a Nobel Prize in physics. I was dumb. No, I respect that. You gotta have some of that arrogance to think you can, right? Even the Nobel Prize winning physicists out there, they've got that little bit of arrogance.
Process and trying something new is always difficult. Luckily, you don't have to do it all on your...
That's another Kurzgesagt video.